Hello everyone, I'm Julia Meyer, Marketing Manager at MPS. Thank you very much for joining MPS and Roden Schwarz for session 3, Power Applications of our Hybrid EMC Workshop Series, which is broadcasted live from our MPS EMC Lab. We're going to wait for just a little bit to allow more attendees to dial into the session 3. This is the last session of our joint EMC workshop with Roden Schwarz. You will be able to find the recordings of yesterday's session online or at our webpage at monolithicpower.com. Please be aware that the webinar is split in 4 parts. After each part, we will do a short Q&A session, if the time will allow us. We will first take questions from our on-site participants. After the second part of the session, we will have a short break and we will come back later then. So please stay in the Zoom webinar. In part 1, Arturo Mediano, who is a professor at the University of Zaragoza in Spain, will present about filter design hints and tricks. In part 2, Christian Kück, field application engineer at MPS, will present about stability in converters, control loop and load step design. As I said before, after this part, we will have a short break, so please stay in the Zoom webinar. In part 3, Arturo Mediano will take over again and will present about how power integrity can cause EMI challenges. And last but not least, in part 4, Francesc, our application engineer at MPS, will present about myth-busting EMC techniques in power converter design. Between the 4 parts, we will have short breaks to change the setup for each speaker. So please do not leave the Zoom webinar. Now a bit of housekeeping before we start. All the online attendees are on mute. Please ask any questions via the Q&A button located on the bottom of the Zoom meeting interface. Questions will be answered at the end of the presentation or via email. We are recording this session and it will be available on demand within the next couple of days. Again, thank you very much for joining Roden Schwarz and MPS, and I'm handing over to Arturo now. Arturo, the stage is yours.
It's okay, can you listen to me?
Yes, now it is working.
Okay.
So perhaps you can start again.
Yes, of course. Good morning again. I was saying only that we are going to cover EMI filter design, basically why a filter can fail. We will have a small demo. We don't have time for complex circuits. And the idea is to explain how we can solve problems in basically conducted emissions. Jan from EMPS was talking about this problem in his speak. But we will try to add some information, some new information. Remember from yesterday, we were talking about passing emissions in radiated test or in conducted test. So filtering is covering more than solving the problems of conducted test. No, but many of the tricks I will be explaining here can be applied in any kind of filter application. Okay, so let's try to consider 4 important comments about filters. The first idea is, what is doing a filter? When you have a problem in EMI, you have 3 elements, the culprit, the victim, and the coupling mechanism. If you are considering to use a filter, it's because you want to introduce here the filter to reduce the coupling mechanism. This coupling mechanism will be conducted. If the coupling mechanism is not conducted, it's through the air or through some kind of dielectric material, what you introduce in the middle is a sealing materials. Okay, might be aluminum or steel or something like that. This is not the best option for solving EMI problems. So remember, the best option is to try to find the culprit and to kill the culprit. For example, you have a ringing, you discover where the ringing is created, you remove the condition for this ringing and you don't need a filter. But sometimes this is impossible. You cannot apply good techniques that remove any kind of noise you can inject in this conductive path. So you need a filter. Okay, second important idea. In EMI, usually we are using passive low pass filters. Low pass because we want to remove high frequencies, and passive because we don't have the possibility for filtering with operational amplifiers. If in your application you can filter, obviously you will be filtering low frequencies, no? And in low frequencies, the big size of the inductors, millihenries, consider for example audio, in audio applications, you can replace a big inductor with the operational amplifier. this is very nice, this is interesting, but remember you will need a power supply for the operational amplifier. Okay, if not, in EMI, we are using inductors, capacitors, resistors, and ferrites. Another important idea is that there is a lot of applications and components. So to give a general design techniques is very difficult. Every application have different possibilities. And finally, but not least, is that when you are filtering, you are doing two different things or a mix of effects. For one point of view, you can do reflection. Reflection means you are using inductors and capacitors, and you are doing the opposite of radio frequency designers. Radio frequency designers are always worried about matching. They want to adapt two systems with different impedances, and they use inductors and capacitors to match the coupling at the desired frequencies. We are doing the opposite. What we want is to mismatch. And this is what you are doing with inductors and capacitors. The EMI don't disappear. The EMI is reflected. In some way, the noise, the energy will be in another part of your circuit. When you are using resistors and ferrites, this component introduces losses and part of the noise will disappear, okay? Because you have heat. This is an important starting point. So let's go to the demo. In the demo, I will be using the same box like yesterday. Remember, it's a metallic box with a power supply cable. And we are going to measure conducted emissions. Remember, in conducted emissions, we start from, 150 kilohertz up to 30 megahertz. You will see the limits, two limits, the quasi-peak limit and the average limit. And you will get something like this. Eh? You have applied all the techniques you know for EMC, but the peaks are over the limits and you need to introduce some filter, no? So let's go to the camera. You can see that I have my box with the power supply cable, and I have here a line impedance stabilization network. Let me show you how I can point, okay? Because the people online don't see the pointer, no? So this is the line impedance stabilization network. I have here 15 volts is the power supply for my system. And I am sending the signal from the line impedance stabilization network to my oscilloscope with this coax line. It's a transmission line. This is long distance. So you need a uniform transmission line. Between the line impedance stabilization network and my instrument, I need a transient protector. Eh? It's some kind of device that clamps transients. Be careful about this, especially if you are in the power electronic business and you have a very expensive EMI receiver, okay? So you send the signal to your oscilloscope or to your spectrum analyzer. I am using one oscilloscope, one RTO oscilloscope. So I am able to see time domain and frequency domain like yesterday. And my system will be powered connecting the cable to the output of the line impedance stabilization network. So my system is now powered, okay, it's working. Eh? Let me show you how is the screen of my software. I am controlling the oscilloscope with this software. So instead of looking at the screen of the oscilloscope, you will see the result in this screen, okay? So you can establish, for example, two limits. This is limit one, the quasi peak, for example, is the same for this one, and the average here, okay? And we make something like setup RTO. So now the oscilloscope is being configured, and what we see here, like limits in the oscilloscope, are mask. You know, mask in oscilloscope is very typical in digital electronics to find if you are making problems with the eye diagram or things like that. No, you can select forbidden areas for your signal. So we are using mask for the limits. No, and I connect to channel number one, the output of the line impedance stabilization network. Let me put here a frequency range for B, for the option B's. Remember, we were from 150 kilohertz to 30 megahertz. I forgot to establish this one before, so let me start again. This one, and we set the RTO, and we recover the traces from the RTO. This is one of the most important things to do in your company, is to replicate the results you have in the official laboratory. This is not easy. You need to prepare a setup, metallic plates. You need to take care about the noise you have in the mains network in your laboratory. I don't know. a lot of things that make this test not so easy like looks in the first impression. Okay, so now I'm going to design a filter. So let's show you the camera, and this is my filter. Okay, my filter is this one. Obviously, this is not a very good filter because I have a lot of parasitics, but I have a pins that make me the possibility to introduce the filter in place. No, it's a small capacitor, 150 nanofarad capacitor. Why we are using capacitors? Oh, I don't know. I am using capacitors because I don't understand inductors, or because inductors are very expensive, or because my inductors have a lot of parasitics, or because in the previous product we were using a capacitor. No, this is the way many companies start designing the filter. They take the filter that was in the previous unit, in the previous model. No, the filter works, they repeat the experience. No, so let's try to introduce a filter in this way. Let's see the camera. I open. Yes, okay, no problem. EMI problems. I was explaining that I have introduced the filter. The filter I am using is this capacitor. You can see it's a red capacitor that is exactly at the input power supply connector of my PC board. No, so 15 volts are coming from this cable, and you can see here that the 15 volts goes to the capacitor, and from the capacitor goes to the PC board. Obviously, this capacitor in a real application will be in the main PC board. No? And we repeat the test. Look at this. We take a picture of the screen. Let me switch to the PC. So you can see that I am taking the response to compare. And now we repeat the test. And we compare. Okay. You can see the result. The result is that no effect at low frequencies and some effect at high frequencies. Because I am 6 dBs below the limits, at least, this is a good option for the high frequencies. So when people don't find solution when the first capacitor is introduced, they want what? They increase the value of the capacitor. Be careful. The capacitor has parasitics. So perhaps at low frequencies, this is a good option. At high frequencies, this is not a good option. The other possibility is to introduce another component, one inductor, where in front or in the source load side or in the load side. I don't know. I'm going to try both positions. No, and you start to increase the number of components. In this process, you can find interesting things, and filters sometimes don't work. So let me show you some ideas about why a filter can fail. This is the slides. The first thing you can consider is if you are filtering in the good position. For example, are you interested in filtering differential mode or common mode? If you are interested in filtering differential mode, one of the first things you will introduce is a capacitor between the lines, like in my example. The other possibility is to introduce one inductor, like this one, or like this one. For the differential mode is the same. Remember, it's an inductor. The core could be iron power or could be ferrite, depending on the frequency range. But it's an inductor. That means what? I am interested in microhenries, in nanohenries. I am interested in inductance. So it's working with the capacitor or alone reflecting. Okay? If you introduce the inductor in one of the lines, it's the same. But usually people don't like the inductor in the ground system. Why? Because this is impedance and you can create some kind of ground bouncing effect, okay? But for example, in a power supply, considering the mains network, 220 volts, 50 hertz, there is no problem to introduce in line or in neutral. Eh? There is no the same situation like in automotive where you have a positive voltage and a ground system, okay? The other possibility is to introduce a ferrite here or here. Remember, look at the component and sometimes look the same, but it's not the same. When you are introducing a ferrite, it's because you want to introduce resistive effects. So you will be working additionally to reflection in some way by dissipation. Second option, common mode. For common mode, you have two circuits, because in this case, common mode currents are in the same direction. So you can introduce not one capacitor, you can introduce two capacitors to some specific reference plane or reference structure, the chassis or something like that. But you need two capacitors. If you don't have the chassis, you will not be able to introduce this solution. And then you will need to introduce something in series. What? Two inductors. You can put one inductor in each line. You need two inductors. What is the problem with these inductors? These inductors will suffer the low frequency currents. For example, if this is a power supply and you have here 5 amps, the 5 amps are circulating in differential mode. So perhaps you can saturate the inductors if they are with core. So the solution is what? The solution is that this inductor is be coupled with a core. That means what? This component is offering inductive effect in both lines for the common mode, but is theoretically invisible for the differential mode, not in the practical application because we have leakage and this is not a perfect common mode choke. But in a general point of view, it's invisible for differential mode signals. And additionally, you can introduce two ferrites, because you have two circuits and you will be filtering by absorption in some way by reflection too, but it's different to the inductor. But this ferrite will be sensitive to the low frequency current like with the inductors. So if you are interested in filtering only common mode, a better solution typically is to introduce a ferrite around the two wires. If you are working in a PCB, this is not possible. And probably you will take the decision of using two ferrite, but you need to take care about saturation. If you introduce the ferrite around the two wires, there is impedance for the common mode and there is no effect for the differential mode. So the first thing to consider when you are going to introduce the filter is what you want to filter. Is differential mode or is common mode noise or both of them? So in your setup, you need to make things to separate the differential mode from the common mode. You can do this, for example, in conducted emissions using two line impedance stabilization networks. And you can combine the output of the line impedance stabilization network using map function in the oscilloscope. You can add or you can subtract to make this kind of analysis. Second possibility to fail with your filter, wrong orientation. Because you are mismatching impedances, when you are using inductors and capacitors, remember this rule. Parallel components must be in the side of height impedance. And series component must be in the side of the low impedance. Because you don't know the terminal impedances, sometimes you need to do something like this. For example, this is from a coffee machine. This is the result from a company filtering conducted emissions in a coffee machine. The red color is the emissions without filter. They design a filter with an inductor and a capacitor, 100 nanofarads, 300 microhenries. And they simulate the result in space. And they think that with this filter, they will go with the red color below the limits. The green color is with what they obtain in the laboratory. Not as expected. Why? Because they are simulating in PSPICE or in LTSPICE or something like that with 50 ohms terminations. This is not what you have in your application. You don't know the terminal impedances. Perhaps you know the impedance of the line impedance stabilization network, but you don't know the output impedance of your product in this frequency range. So people, when obtaining this result, what do? Something like this. They introduce another component. Why? In this position, for example, a capacitor. This is what people do. Or perhaps increase the value of the capacitor or increase the value of the inductor. But if they introduce a new component, they introduce a capacitor. Why? I don't know. They don't understand inductors. They don't like inductors. These inductors are expensive. I don't know. Many possibilities. And they solve the problem. My suggestion is before doing this, mirror the filter. The difference can be from 20 to 40 dBs in difference. You can try this in your laboratory. If you make this test and you get this situation, that means what? The mains side of your filter has a higher impedance than the output impedance of your coffee machine in differential mode, because the result is better with this orientation than with this orientation. If the result is the opposite, that means that the output of your product in this mode is higher than the input impedance of the line impedance stabilization network. Okay, so remember in EMI, because we don't know the terminal impedances, filters are not symmetrical. For radio frequency people, filters are symmetrical because they are working with 50 ohms and 50 ohms always, or 75 ohms. But in EMI, this is not possible to know. It's very complicated to measure the output impedance of your product in a frequency range like this. Another important thing, perhaps you are not using the good order for your filter. For example, if you introduce one component, a capacitor or a series inductor, you will get something like minus 20 degrees per decade. If you introduce more components, every component you introduce will start to increase plop, 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 the slope of the attenuation band. If you increase, if you have a capacitor, if you increase the value of the capacitor, you get something like this. You go with the cutoff frequency at lower values, but the slope will be the same, like this one, minus 20 dBs per decade, because you are increasing the value, you are reducing the cutoff frequency, but the slope will be slower. Look at this, because if you are introducing components, sometimes this is a good strategy to obtain 20, 40 dBs more at some frequencies, instead of increasing the value of the component that introduced parasitics. The next possibility to fail are specifically parasitics. Here is where it's very important to have good information from the data sheet, or you have an impedance analyzer in your laboratory, so you can test your capacitors and especially your inductors. In my experience, the most difficult component to model is inductors, and especially inductors with core, because depending on the size of the component, the winding, blah, 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 you can have not only one resonant frequency, you can have different resonant frequencies. And in these resonant frequencies, you will get something like parasitic effects, magic, remember. But if you see the response in the impedance analyzer and the position of these resonant frequencies match the frequencies where you are failing, you can think, these emissions are bigger at these frequencies because the inductor has these parasitic resonances. That is because it's not possible to compare in EMI inductors only with the value. 1 millihenry inductor, this is equivalent. Another 1 millihenry inductor, this is not true. You need to check how is the frequency response of the component. Okay, look at this. If you have a low pass filter, you will be expecting something like this from your theoretical response, something like this. If you introduce parasitics in your components and of course in the layout, you will get things like this. So for example, at this frequency range, around 30 megahertz, I have no attenuation like I was predicting by my theoretical analysis. That is because in conducted emissions, filtering from 1 megahertz to 30 megahertz is very difficult, especially in power electronics. Because in power electronics, the components are big. And big means in radio frequency, high parasitics. So the best thing to do in EMI is not to create noise between 1 and 30 megahertz. Because if you create this noise, it will be very difficult to filter. It's not the same like the first harmonics of your switching frequencies, no? 100 kilohertz, 200 kilohertz. These kind of frequencies can be filtered easily. Not easily, but in an easier way. Next point, temperature. If in your application you are using cores and the inductors or the ferrites are close to a hot area, think for example in a cooking machine, when you are cooking, it's a very strong activity in temperature, the behavior of the core change, and perhaps you have an anomalous behavior. Sixth, the value of the components change with the excitation. For example, capacitors. Oh, what a very big value of capacitance, a lot of microfarads in a very, very small package. In engineering, you know, something is very good, don't be happy. Something is wrong or dangerous, no? So for example, if you go to very, very small capacitors and you check in the data sheet, how is the value of the capacitor with no DC level or low frequency voltage applied? And what happens if you introduce, I don't know, 3 volts in the line where you are filtering, 3 volts of DC make that the capacitor has 60% less in value than the nominal capacitance when there is no DC. So if you are filtering a power supply network or you are decoupling, what happened? The 100 microfarad value, or in this example, the 4.7 microfarad value is reduced in the moment you apply 3 volts additionally to the noise you want to filter. This is something similar with inductors. In inductors, if you have a value without DC current or low frequency current, you will get a nominal value, I don't know, 5.5 microhenries. But if you look in the data sheet or you measure with your frequency response analyzer, you will see that for 4 amps, the 5.5 microhenries inductor goes to 4.5 microhenries inductor. At the end, if you increase a lot the current, you can fully saturate the inductor. That means it's like, not exactly, but it's like the inductor is an air core inductor. The core disappear. So there is no filtering effect. This is the same with ferrites. Remember from yesterday, what is a ferrite? It's a component that is offering some kind of impedance at a frequency range, no? For example, this ferrite is good for 400 megahertz. It's around 100 ohms in series. But if additionally to the 100 megahertz signal you want to filter, you have some kind of current, for example, 1 amp, the 100 ohms goes to 50 ohms. And if you increase to 4 amps, you go to 18 ohms. So this is another typical situation where your component is failing. It's because you are thinking in the noise you want to filter, but you are not considering the DC or the AC current. Low frequencies, typically. 9 points is where you put the filter. This is extremely important, okay? If you see at my experiment, let me show you here, I can introduce an additional filter for my application, no? Let me remove my capacitor and let me start with this filter. Another, here again, is a very big filter, but this to be able to work in a good way in the demo, no? This kind of filter probably in this application is in the PCB with SMD components. So what I am using is 2 capacitors and 1 inductor here in the middle. It's a third order filter. Capacitor, inductor, capacitor, no? So I'm going to introduce the filter in position. So you can see from this point of view, okay, let me connect the filter. Oh, sorry. Here, and then the power supply cable here. This way. What I am trying to explain, let me show you with the camera. You can see here. Let's go down with the camera. I am trying to explain that this is not the good position for the filter. The filter must be here, exactly where the cable is going in and out. Additionally to this position, the idea is that this component must be filtered. This is the good strategy for to have a strong effect from the filter. If not, what happened? The noise that you are creating will be coupled to the filtered line, and the noise goes out, for example, from the inductor in the DC-DC converter. Or additionally, if you are receiving a transient, before the transient being filtered, the transient can be coupled to your sensitive area. So this is not a good position for the filter. So that is because in the mechanical design, you need to consider this area is for the filter. And let's prepare the mechanical design with some kind of a metallic enclosure. So the filter will be introduced in this position. This is magical. you can see how the filter is located. The inductor is not on top of the PCB. It's outside of the PCB, because if the inductor is close to the area where you have a lot of noise, we saw this yesterday with the near field probe, the noise is coupled to the inductor and goes out. We will do this in the demo. So let's see what happens if I see the response now in my screen. So this is what I get now. This is my previous, I need to update this one. And this is my previous result here. You can see the difference. Now the filter is working. What I need to consider is what? Look at this, this signal here. This signal here is not from my device. You need to make a measurement of the ambient noise. Let me switch off my product. My product is off now. Let me repeat the test. You can see the noise is here. Where is coming this noise? It's coming from my power supply. So if you are trying to test your product with a switching mode power supply in your laboratory, take care, because the power supply can have a lot of noise. No, here is where a very big, heavy linear power supply is so important, also useful in a laboratory. If not, you need to filter. In my setup, I am using a filter here. Let me show you with the camera. This is the filter I am using between my power supply and my line impedance stabilization network. This filter is not a good option to minimize this emission, but it's enough to have not a very high level, no? So let's try to do a change. Let me repeat the test. Let me power the circuit here, something like this. And let me show you again the result of my measurement. This is what I get. Look at this. The first harmonic is below the limits. Perhaps some kind of risk here, no? But my box is open. The cable is not in a good position. If we prepare a good setup, probably this is 3 or 4 dBs lower than you see here. But this is not what is important. Let me try. Let me try if we can make a better setup. Let me see. Something like this. This way. And let me repeat. Only moving. Okay. It's similar, not better. But let me do something. Let me save this in memory. Okay. And let me make a change. I hope it will work. This is with the original position. And now let me open the circuit. Let me disconnect this one. I take another piece of wire. Something like this. To connect to the PCB. And now I am working with the filter to be close to the DC-DC converter. Look at this. Now the filter is here. So the idea is that perhaps the filter is in another PCB. Okay, so I can put the filter in position here, in this situation. Yeah? You can see that the filter is on top of the PCB. This is something like this. Let's go to the iPath here and consider, for example, I have seen this problem many, many times. No, you have a PC board here and another PC board on top. Okay, and then, for example, you have the filter is here. And here you have a strong activity creating noise. If the filter is on top of the aggressive area, you will have coupling. Let me show you. We go to the camera and let me measure again. Okay, and let's compare. This is the difference. You can see that depending of where the filter is located, the same components, the same topology with the same parasitics are over the limits or are below the limits. or close to be below the limits. This is very easy to test because you can take the filter and you put the filter outside of the product. The filter outside of the product is able to comply with regulation. When the filter is inside of the product, you fail. You increase 10 dBs, 5 dBs, 12 dBs, something like that. Then that is important, the position of the filter in your product. Especially take care if the filter is close to head sinks with a strong DVDT from power electronic circuits or close to magnetic field sources like my inductor in this back converter. Very aggressive elements. Okay, let's try to see this in this picture. Okay, what do you see here? Can you tell me what you see here that is wrong? Where is the filter? The filter is in the PCB here. And is a good option? No, because all the components of the filter are mixed in a random way, no? This is not a good orientation for the filter. The filter must be in line. Input is here, you put the components, and output is here. If you mix all the components in the PCB, you will have feedback between the components. You have parasitic capacitive and inductive coupling between the components, and you will fail. And if you fail, what do you need to put in the connector? Something in the last minute to pass the test. Capacitors or components, some ferrites to filter in the good position. This is the good position for the filter. But you want to save money introducing the filter here. So you have problems. No problem. How is the sentence? Is there is no time to do things in a good way in the first time. There is no time, but we have all the time to repeat and repeat and repeat again. No, so think about these ideas. This is very important. Where you put the filter, and if the filter is shielded, there is a strong difference. What is this? This is resin. Be careful with your science. If you are in the business of electronics and you are introducing all your electronics covered with resins, I don't know why, because thermal purposes or because environmental protection or something like that, resins have a dielectric constant of, 4, 5, 7. That means what? The capacitive coupling between the elements in your circuit will increase 5, 6 times more when the components are covered by resin. What happened with the low-cost resins? The low-cost resins have less inductance, less permittivity. So they are better for this application, but they are not environmentally permitted. You cannot use it because they are dangerous for the environment. Okay, so you go to a very good material, considering thermal purposes or environmental conditions, you will get this problem. And then the designer of the filter is testing that the filter is good for the application, but when the product goes to the process to introduce resin, you fail in conducted emissions by 3, 4, 5, 6 dBs. Why? If the product is considered, be careful about this. An additional effect with these resins is that when you go to the thermal chamber, these materials sometimes contract and change the mechanical dimensions with heat and cold, when it goes from heat to cold and from cold to heat, and they can broken the cores in some chokes, no? Because of the mechanical stress you are creating in the component. If you create a break in the core, the inductance disappear. So there is no component. Visually, you see the component. The component is in place, but there is no inductance. Okay? Two times, I have seen this in the past. Be careful about parasitics in the layout. This is what I was trying to explain, no? If your filter is here, let me change the color. If your filter is here, remember that you are doing something like this for the signal you want to filter, no? So you will have the possibility to have this coupling. This effect is very well known by radio frequency designers. So if you look at this picture, this is from a filter that is something like this, is inductor, 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 and two capacitors, the blue components, okay? So you can see how the inductors are located, placed in the PCB. They are 90 degrees rotated because they are trying to minimize the effect. If you test this filter in your simulation, you will get something like this. But what happens if you build the circuit? You will get something like this. I don't know, something like that. Why? Because the real circuit you are building is something like this. You have mutual inductance between the inductors when they are coupled. So the high frequency noise trying to go in this direction find in this coupling a good path to bridge the filter. So be careful. In my experience, the most important thing in the filter is not only the value of the component you are using or the topology, it's how you implement this filter. You need to read, you need to study the fundamentals of radio frequency design to understand these effects. This is the last one. No, we have another one. Is be careful about this coupling we were speaking before, and be careful about this connection, no? The connections you specify in your schematic, like low impedance, must be low impedance. If you introduce small wires or vias or big long traces in the path of your capacitors, there is no low impedance to ground. You have inductive effect. No? This is typical if you put the wide capacitors in your filter in the PCB, and then you connect these capacitors to the chassis with standoffs, metallic standoffs, or long wires, then the filter is fully different if you test the filter outside of the product. Oh, wait, the last possibility. In my experience, when you solve a problem for conducted emissions and you use a component, I don't know, from Booth Electronics, from EPCOS, from good companies, what happened? Many companies say, let's try an equivalent that is low cost. Let's go to some place. Okay? It's a 100 microhenries inductor. For sure, we can find something that is cheaper. Always you will find someone that say they can do cheaper, but perhaps it's not the same. Okay, so be careful. You need to test the components. The response with voltage, with current, with saturation, with temperature, blah, blah, blah. Well, so that's all. I hope you enjoy it. And you know how difficult it is to design an LC filter. Okay, so it's okay.
Thanks a lot, Arturo. So we have time for two questions. So I will read out the first question. Regarding the current slide with the title One Wrong Mode, in CM, each cap should be connected to one line, correct? It was about the slide with the title One Wrong Mode. And the question is, in CM, each cap should be connected to one line, correct? The question is, in CM, each cap should be connected to one line, correct?
Oh, yes. This is wrong. Yes. This is, but I have not these kind of errors. These errors are to see if you detect it, no? If you are not sleeping, no, this is wrong. Okay, obviously, good point. This is here. Okay, it's one capacitor from each line to the chassis, for example. Good point.
So is there one question from the audience we have here at our MPS location? No. So if
yes, one question.
The capacitance form,
considered? Yes, in some application can be considered. I say yes, but the answer is it depends. If you detect something wrong in your filter, could be working for you. So really, I have found people simulating the filter with electromagnetic simulation in 3D. So you can identify these coupling, parasitic couplings easily.
Can Arturo, can you repeat the question for the online audience, please?
Yes, he is explaining what about the parasitic capacitive effect that you have between the coils and some kind of enclosure or metallic element that is around the component. And it's true, this coupling from the components to external elements is very important and can affect in some frequencies or can create parasitic resonances or parasitic paths for the signals, no? So that is because the filter is one of the ways to avoid these effects is that the filter is shielded. If you seal the filter and you test the filter outside and it's working perfectly, when you introduce the filter in the product, is fully isolated from the environment. And you can put the filter in this situation or in this situation, and in theory, there will not be big changes.
Thank you very much, Arturo. Yep. So for the online audience, we are switching the setup now, and it will take 2 or 3 minutes. So please stay online